When airplanes fall out of the sky, when trains collide, when oil platforms explode, or when nuclear cores suffer a meltdown, we always ask the same question. Was it technical failure or human error? Why do we ask this question? And when did we start to ask this question? And who introduced this apparent dualism of accident causality? In 1931, Herbert William Heinrich was the first one to make the claim that he had conducted a scientific analysis of accidents. Following a systematic categorization of a vast dataset, he drew the conclusion that industrial accidents can be caused by either technical failure or unsafe acts of people. And it had to be either or. Which also means that if you rule out one of these two, it must be the other one. We've found no evidence that there was a technical failure, so human it is then. And according to Heinrich, most of the time human it was. In 88% of the accidents Heinrich studied, he claimed the cause was unsafe acts of people. And still today we teach operators of high-risk systems that 75% or something similar of accidents are caused by human factors. And we spend much time and efforts on human-targeted research and programs to make the humans more reliable in order to change this ratio. So why then did this dualism become the norm? Well, it makes sense and it's easy to comprehend, right? Someone or something has to be at blame, right? And if we look at media reports today, this dualism is apparent. Something or someone made a mistake, right? That's why the accident happened. Someone made a mistake or something malfunctioned. Just look at the 2016 train crash in Germany that killed 11 people. Just days after the accident, the German Minister of Transport was quoted to conclude that since no technical failure could be identified, the accident must have been caused by a terrible human error. Now, Heinrich could have had other motives for building this accident dualism theory. Motives that touches on the power relations of the actors in the industrialized world. You see, Heinrich was working for the insurance industry, where he was analyzing industrial workers' harm claim files. And if he could show that the worker harmed himself, yeah, no gender perspective at this time, by an unsafe act, the claim could be dismissed. It's really a shame that Heinrich never left any of his data for us to reanalyze. That could have saved him from insinuating suggestions like the one I just made. But safety science and practice has not been as one-sided as I might make it sound. During the end of the Second World War, a critique of this perspective was developed and a new scientific school of thought emerged as a result. The field's pioneers, including Chapanis, Fitz and Jones, claimed that rather than labeling accidents as fundamentally technical or human, we need to understand interactions between technology and people. For example, how technology can contribute to or foster what seems like human error and how human-machine coordination and synchronization can be improved. What they founded was a scientific field that we today call human factors. So, to go back to the question, was it technical failure or human error? Today, with the vast research that the human factors community has produced for the last 60 years, the answer should probably be no. It was not technical failure or human error. The question is wrong. The system is much more complex than this dualism allows for. And in order to understand the causes of accidents, we must do our best to understand this complexity. Accidents can happen when all components and actors are working as intended, and even when they are not working as intended, accidents typically do not happen. We must understand the interactions and relations between the system actors and components to understand how accidents happen as well as how safety is guaranteed.